who are on campus. We want to welcome you back, and those who are with us via live stream, our online community, we welcome y'all back as well. Hope that you've had a restful summer that's been full of ministry and that you've seen countless souls saved through the power of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to just touch on a couple of things as we get this semester started. First, tonight there is a welcome back dinner in Kelly Hall, and that is free to you, but we have had to move the time of that because of evening classes, so please note that time change. It will not be at 5:30, it will be at 6:30, so if you have an evening class tonight, you will be able to participate in that, and it'll be about 6:30 getting started, so when you get over from finished with your class, going over to Kelly Hall, and you can partake in the activities. There will be a prayer walk that's a part of that, and Todd, Becky Davis will be leading you in that, and so we're thankful for them as well. Also, I want to remind you that you need to tap in and tap out of chapel in order to have a record of your attendance, so please don't forget to do that either with your ID card. Our guest preacher today, it's always an honor when we get to hear from our president, because he's a president with a pastor's heart who can preach the Word of God. And we're grateful and thankful for Dr. Donnie Fox. He's a product of our great institution. He was raised and spent the majority of his life here on this campus, and he's been serving at Clear Creek since 1999. He holds a Master's of Divinity and a PhD from Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky. He has 30-plus years in ministry, and those ministries span everything from being involved in youth ministry, music ministry, and pastoral ministry. And so I know you join me today in praying for Dr. Fox and for God to speak through him into our hearts and into our lives. Before our worship team comes today and gets us started in singing praises unto the Lord, Ryan Chapman's going to come, and he's going to open us in a word of prayer. Brother Ryan, you come on, brother.
Good morning, everybody. There was one prayer request in the prayer request box. It's from Alex Wheeler. He says, please pray for my friend Thomas Reef, because he's having brain surgery tomorrow. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for this privilege to be able to come here and to worship you. And Father, we know that without you, we can't do anything. And Lord, we need you more than we've ever needed you ever before. And Father, we know that the devil's a defeated foe, and we know that Jesus Christ, you're our Lord, and you're Lord forevermore. And Father, we thank you that you sent your Son Jesus to die for us and to rise again for us. And Father, we thank you for saving rotten sinners like us from what we truly deserve. And Father, we know that you're worthy of all the praise today. And Lord, I just want to pray for Dr. Fox. I pray for him as he preaches. I pray, Father, that you would bless him and just help him in all of his ways. And Father, I pray for every need here today. Lord, I know that there's many, whether it be medical, physical, financial, and I realize that the greatest need is spiritual. So Father, I ask that you would meet every need. And Father, I pray that we would think about this service as the days and the weeks go by, and that we would be changed because we could say that we've met with you and we've done business with you, and it's been so good to be here. And Father, I ask that you would lead us and guide us and strengthen our minds and our hearts, and we'll give you the praise and the glory, for we ask in Jesus' most high and most precious name. Amen.
Amen. Well, Clear Creek, it's great to see everybody back again, freshmen. This is the beginning of a long journey for you guys, so what better way to do it than start and stand and worship with us? Let's worship our Savior together.
Yeah.
the Lord praise this morning. Well, any of the students and definitely faculty and staff that have been around me this past year knows exactly what I'm about to say. Nothing of eternal significance is accomplished apart from prayer. I will say that all the way, hopefully till my dying day, when I finally get to be in face-to-face presence of God. And, here at Clear Creek, we take a time, every single chapel, to set aside to give you the opportunity to come to this altar, to even sit at your chair or stand in praise, just to have a moment of silence in the midst of everything, especially this first week of school, all the syllabus and tests and things that are going to be coming up. That's enough to stress anybody out, but God can handle every bit of it and so much more than that. And so I pray you take advantage of these times, every chapel, and we don't do it out of vain repetition. We do it out of that heart of worship, which we're going to sing about. So after this prayer time, I pray you will join and sing with me. But now, let's come in this time of prayer.
For a song in itself.
through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. And I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. And I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we can stand here before you at the beginning of a new school year, Lord, knowing that your blood is what brings us here, that you have covered us in that, Lord, and now you look upon us through the lens of Jesus. And God, we are not righteous, Lord, but you see his righteousness through us. Oh God, how I pray you keep us humble of that fact. And Lord, that we begin this semester humble, Lord, without any sense of pride in our hearts, Lord, from staff to faculty to student, Lord. I pray every single one of us are humbled at the fact that we can stand before you, not only in this chapel, but in the classroom, God, and worship you, Lord, through what you've called us to do. And all the ministries that are going to come, Lord, from the individuals in this room, Lord, oh, we pray it will be a mighty force. As we have said before, it only takes that faith of a mustard seed, but oh, what you can do with something so small, God. So, Lord, I pray that you begin to kindle that mustard seed in each of our hearts now, God. And, Lord, as Dr. Fox comes to bring the message, the first message of the semester, let it be one, Lord, that you have laid fresh on his heart, that comes straight from your word, that penetrates to each one of us, God, about what you want us to do as we begin this new semester. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, if you've been anywhere around the TV this week, you've seen it on the news, you've seen the headlines, and it's just about something that's become commonplace anymore, these senseless tragedies that take place, the shootings and things like that. It seems like anymore that they've just become commonplace and we just kind of gloss over them anymore. But it's been throughout these last few days that I've heard this question many times. How can a loving God allow this to happen? How can a loving God allow this to happen? I think about those senseless tragedies that take place, and I think about in our own lives, most of us have heard this question asked one time or another in our lives when we've had situations going on around us. It's usually after a senseless tragedy like we've just experienced, or maybe after a natural disaster or something like that. But what I want to focus on today as we begin our semester today is that maybe even some of us has asked that question about our lives today. Maybe throughout the course of this semester, your faith, your walk with the Lord will be challenged because of some hard times. Maybe there'll be some faith challenges for you this semester. Right now, at the beginning of the semester, the enemy's found a way to get a foothold into your heart and into your mind, and you're wondering, you know, God, where are you at? And maybe that trust level has fallen just a little bit. The song we just sang, you know, reminded us of that tempter's snare. And he tries to take us to the lowest level that he can. So I began to pray as I prayed about what God would have me to challenge us with this morning. I want us to think about times when our faith is challenged. Times when our trust level is challenged. And maybe you're not there right now, but maybe throughout the course of this semester you will. And hopefully you'll remember the Word of God that I've taken you to today that will maybe encourage you and strengthen you when those times come when our faith is challenged, when our trust level is challenged. Because you see, we have to remember that the enemy's oldest trick, is to entice us into question about God's love for us, God's care for us. That's his oldest trick. And we know, going back to the beginning of time in the book of Genesis, Adam and Eve there in the garden, his most deceptive trick that he ever did was to get them to doubt God's word and God's rules and regulations. And what happened throughout that course of disobedience? Sin and death entered into the world. Satan knows what he's doing, doesn't he? The enemy knows what he's doing. He's no dummy. You fast forward generations later, and Satan challenged Job's faith in God by what did he do? Took everything he had, didn't he? Took his wealth, his business, his means of producing income, took his employees, and worst of all, his children in a single day. But when Job refused to waver in his faith, Satan went on and cruelly attacked his health, He inflicted him with a painful and repulsive disease, but the Bible tells us that Job still stood strong in his faith. But those are challenging times, aren't they? The enemy knows that we're in a covenant relationship with the Lord. He can't take our relationship away with the Lord, but man, he can challenge our faith. He can challenge our trust. He can cause us to question God's commitment to us because we feel like we're out in no man's land. Well, that's why I love the fact that God included the Psalms in his word, because I want to take you to the Psalm 62 this morning. Psalm 62. And I want to take you to a time in King David's life where here in this 62nd Psalm where King David, when he wrote this, you can see it from the words here as he wrote through the power of the Holy Spirit. He was immersed in a situation, I believe you can see right here, that challenged his faith in God. Now, let me say to you, there's nothing wrong. Just because we say we're going through a challenge, that doesn't demean you or anything. That's part of the spiritual battle that you and I face, okay? Just because you say your faith is being challenged or your trust is being challenged doesn't mean you're somewhat less of a Christian or anything like that. Listen, that's just part of our walk with the Lord, because the enemy doesn't like what we're doing. And he wants to rob us of that joy that God wants us to have to the fullest in our lives. So when even King David, a man as great as him, I love the fact that God included in his word that even this great man of God had challenges to his faith. And while the Psalm's heading does not identify a specific setting, we can see here that it indicates that his enemies were trying to take him down. Okay? They were trying to do everything they could to discredit him and to take him down from his position. So as we look at this 62nd Psalm, I think that when we take the Bible, we pull it into our lives and say, Lord, how does this apply to our lives? I would have to say to you that because we live in a sin-cursed world today, we can be sure that we are going to face circumstances that are going to challenge our faith, okay? Because this is not utopia here on Clear Creek Baptist Bible College's campus. I've told every one of you that. As a matter of fact, I've told you when you come here, you're probably going to have more challenges to your faith than before you came here. So we live in a sin-cursed world, and all of us are probably going to have to ask this question: how can God allow this to happen? Why is this going on right now? But the question is, how do we respond to those challenges to our faith? I believe that we can learn from this text and apply to our own lives some principles that help us when those challenges come. Look at the 62nd Psalm, and I'm going to read through this. I'll stop at different times. I want to show you two or three things here. Psalm 62 says, truly, my soul silently waits for God. From Him comes my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. How long will you attack a man? You shall be slain, all of you, like a leaning wall and a tottering fence. They only consult to cast him down from his high position. They delight in lies. They bless with their mouth, but they curse inwardly. My soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. In God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Now, I want to stop there just a minute, because I want to show you two or three different principles from this text that I believe that can help us when the challenges come. When the challenge to our faith comes And perhaps you find yourself asking that question, how can a loving God allow this to happen, not just out in the world, but how can a loving God allow this to happen to me? Well, how can I respond to that? I believe we respond just like King David. I see from the Word here the first thing that we do when those challenges come is simply this. We must wait quietly on God. Okay? Now, a lot of times, listen, that's the hardest thing for us to do because a lot of times we're impatient, aren't we? But when those challenges come, I believe God's Word through King David here says, the first thing I've got to do is I've got to settle down and I must wait quietly on God. Now, when you look at these first seven verses here, I'm going to walk you through this text here. Notice that even though he was facing a serious challenge, David, here's what I like. David could honestly say here, look at verse 1, he could honestly say that his soul was resting in God. Okay? Now, don't skim over that first verse. Remember now, the potentials there, God, why are you letting this happen? But the first thing David says is, my soul is resting in God. Now, notice he says, truly my soul silently, if you're using the New King James Version, what I'm using, it says he silently waits for God. And that's what that word means in the original language. It simply means to be at rest, to be still, to be quiet. You see, sometimes in the midst when the enemy's trying to get a foothold in my life and he's trying to shake up things around me, sometimes I want to just start blurting out at the mouth, and sometimes I just need to shut up and be quiet and rest and rest. And we're going to talk about why we do that in just a minute. But notice the first thing you see here, he was waiting quietly on God, realizing that what he could do was beyond him. Realizing that he could do nothing to change his situation, David said, I'm going to wait quietly on God to deliver him. Okay? His soul, what I want you to see here, first of all, his soul was at peace. God was empowering him to overcome whatever fear or anxiety or distress that his enemies were causing him. So when those challenges come, I believe God's Word tells us the first thing that I've got to focus on is to quietly wait on God. Now you say, Brother Donnie, well, that's easy. Why do you do that? Well, look at these first seven verses. The first reason that I think we wait quietly on God is in verses 1 and 2 because, first of all, the Bible reminds us that God alone is sufficient to help. Okay? You see? Now look at verse 2. Circle that word only, because believe me, challenges are going to come to you. And I want you to go back to the 62nd Psalm. He says, he only. Circle that word. Underline that word. He only is my rock and salvation. You see, David knew that just being still for a moment and silently waiting on God, that was his only recourse, okay? That was his recourse. His only hope for salvation, by that word salvation means literally deliverance. Deliverance from that situation. His only avenue was through the Lord, okay? That's what he started out on in facing this challenge. Only God was sufficient to help him, trusting fully in the Lord to protect him from these enemies. David declares that God and God alone was his rock, his defense, his fortress. That one place we see there in verse 2 that he knew he was safe. Now, I love the book of Psalms, all of the Psalms, because all throughout, especially King David's writings, you hear these terms, my rock, my fortress, my defense. And when you get into original languages, you see that these terms speak of, it's talking about a stronghold, a high fortified place where the enemies cannot reach. You get that? He's talking about God is my fortress, that high place, that fortified place where ultimately the enemies can do a lot of stuff, but they can't ultimately reach me there. God is my fortress. God was his refuge. Therefore, he would not be moved, and he would not be shaken. In other words, David could rest calmly because he knew a very important truth. He knew that he was in a covenant relationship with God. And I want to tell you what, God honors his covenant. You see, a lot of times when those challenges come, we forget. Yeah, we may say, well, I'm a Christian. Why does this happen to me? And the enemy starts getting his foothold in. But we forget that we're in a covenant relationship, folks, and God's on the other end. And God's not forgotten about you. God's not forgotten about me. David knew that he was in a covenant relationship with God, and he was convinced that God would do all that he had promised for him. So should you and I. When the challenges come, we can wait. We must wait quietly on God, first of all, because he alone is sufficient to help us. But look at verses 3 and 4. There's another reason that we must wait quietly on God, as David reminds us, is that he alone is able to protect us from our opponents. And that you'll notice there in verses 3 and 4 that certainly David's enemies were many and they were strong. They continued to threaten, and here we see that they were literally attacking him relentlessly. And David knew that God alone was the only one able to protect him from his opponents. And you see there in verse 4 that despite his enemies' persistence, David firmly believed that God would protect him. He says, they only consult to cast him down from his high position. They delight in lies. They bless with their mouth, but they curse inwardly. But then look up there in verse 3. He says, how long you think you're going to last attacking me? You'll all be slain. He said, you're only like a leaning wall or a tottering fence when it comes to going against God, whom I'm in a covenant relationship with. You see, he was able to wait quietly on God because he knew that God alone is sufficient for his help. He knew that God alone was able to protect him from all of his opponents. And then you get to verse 5 and 7. Notice what he redoes in this text. He says, I can wait quietly on God because I know that God alone is the one that gives me true rest and security. Notice in verse 5 and 7, it's kind of like after you get past verses 3 and 4, after David began to focus on naming the wicked deeds of his enemies, it kind of stirred up that anger or that anxiety in his spirit again. And notice in verses 5 through 7, he quickly brings his feelings under control again, commanding his soul to wait on God. He says, my soul, again, he's saying, wait silently for God alone. It's like he's going this way in those emotions, and he's thinking about his enemies coming at him. And again, he has to step back and say, now, soul, be still. Wait silently on God. You see, he has to go back and forth too. It's not just a one-time thing. This is a battle, folks. And he's saying, soul, now wait quietly on God. He notice there in verses 5 through 7, he just really re-emphasizes his firm conviction that only God could give him genuine rest and security. And there in the midst of this challenging situation, there in the midst of this threatening situation, he stated once again that God and God alone was his hope, his rock, the giver of his glory or his victory and honor, and his rock of strength and his place of refuge. When those challenges come, you and I must wait quietly on God because he alone is our refuge. He alone brings that trust and that security to us. And you see, the challenge for us is, as we pull this into our lives and think about what's going on today or what may come down the road, when our faith is challenged, listen, and I'm speaking from personal experience, we have to resist our natural tendency to worry, you see, because that's our natural tendency, is to worry. And you and I have to face that head on. We're faced with a challenge just to automatically zoom to worry or fear or doubt God's love or where's God at? Instead, we simply need to take King David's example here and learn to simply wait on the Lord. And when we finally trust Him, we find the rest for our souls that King David found right here. You see, listen, no one else can give us that peace in the midst of those troubling times. God alone can enable us to rest when the storms of life are raging all around us, and Jesus personally invites us to come to Him for rest. I love how He ministered to His own closest disciples there in John chapter 16 and verse 33 when they were worried about Him leaving them and they would be left behind. And you remember that verse in John chapter 16 and verse 33? He said, "These things have I spoken to you that in me you might have peace." You see, in the world you shall have tribulation, He said, "but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world." That's what Jesus says to you and me today. That's why David, with his faith in Almighty God, could say, "My soul, my inner being, I gladly wait and rest in the Lord. And I know that I'm in a covenant relationship with God, and my fortified place is in God alone. And I know God will not let my enemies take me down." You see, when our faith is challenged, I know it gets frustrating. When our faith is challenged, I know we feel helpless at times. And many times that can spill over into words and deeds that come out of us that shouldn't come out, that are not worthy of those of us who walk with the Lord. But those desperate, unchanging circumstances tend to bring out the worst in us many times. That's what the enemy wants from us. And they cause us many times to become angry at God, to blame Him, or to think that He just simply doesn't care. But listen to me, friends, during those times, that's when we need to simply wait quietly on the Lord and face that challenge head on. Face that challenge head on. Just like David did, he waited silently on God. I refer back again to where the Bible records that Job, again, remember, upon losing all of his livestock, his servants, and his children in a single day, he did not sin by foolishly accusing God, did he? He did not. What did the Bible say in Job chapter 1 and verse 22? After all of that happened, it said, "In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly." When our faith is challenged, I believe one of the first things we must focus on is simply waiting silently on God. Now, move on down. Look at verses 8 through 10. Notice what he continued to say. He says, "Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him." Circle that word "before." Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us. Surely men of low degree are a vapor. Men of high degree are a lie. If they are weighed on the scales, they are altogether lighter than vapor. Do not trust in oppression, nor vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. A second principle from this passage: when my faith is challenged, when my trust in God is challenged, not only should I focus on waiting quietly on God, secondly, I believe King David shows us that I must focus on trusting God at all times. trusting God at all times. Now, notice what happens here with the progression during this psalm. After sharing, first of all, how his soul had found rest in the Lord, David instructs us now how to find this same calmness when our faith is challenged. Now, notice in verses 8 through 10 here, the key, David wrote, is to give God my burdens and fully trust Him. Now, notice I didn't say semi-fully trust Him. Notice what David is saying here. He's saying, give God your burdens and fully trust Him. At all times, in every season, in every circumstance of my life, I should put my confidence in God. Okay? Now, notice at verse 8, notice how David breaks this down. When I talk about we must trust God at all times, look at verse 8. First of all, David says that involves pouring out my heart to God. Why do you do that, Brother Donnie? Because notice what David says, I pour out my heart to Him because He and He alone is my refuge. See, that's the one. That's the one that I should want to pour my heart out to. Because He is my refuge. So look there again at verse 8. David exhorts us to fully unburden ourselves. You see, church, listen to me. We walk around too many times burdening ourselves when David says what we ought to be doing is unburdening ourselves. You got a refuge. Pour out your heart to Him. Pour out your heart to Him. Don't burden yourself. David says, unburden yourselves by pouring out your heart to God. You see, one of the greatest lessons of the Psalms is that God has given us the precious liberty, of emptying our souls to Him. Okay? Listen, folks, sometimes I believe we just take that for granted. We go mouth a few words, we get up in the morning or we spend some time and we mouth a few words. But listen, God wants us to empty our souls to Him. He's our refuge. And God has given us the precious liberty of emptying our souls, everything that we are thinking and feeling before Him. Look at verse 8, circle that word before. Notice what David says. Trust in Him, you people. Pour out your heart before Him. I love that word before. You need to highlight that or circle it or whatever. When you look at that word in the original language, it's a form of the word that is used for face. Okay? And it means that God wants us to be as close to Him as we want to be. He wants to be face to face with us. We use that expression sometimes. We don't want people getting in our face. We say, get out of my face. Well, listen, God says, get in my face. That's what that word means when He says, pour out your hearts before Him. It means in His face. Don't worry about getting so far down on your knees, but get in His face. That's what He says, pour out your heart before Him. Literally, we can pour out our hearts before God's face. Why? Again, David says, because He's our refuge. He's our shelter. He's our security. See, when we are hiding in Him, when we are hiding in Him, we are free from our cares when we're in His face. But before we can truly take shelter in God, we've got to release our burdens to Him. We have to trust Him to sustain us and handle every situation, every circumstance that affects us. So you see, the second thing David shows us here is not only must we wait on God, but we must trust in God at all times. Pour out our heart to Him. He's our refuge. Now, when you look at verses 9 and 10, here's the challenge to this, because you see, we are such a self-sufficient people that we think we can do it on our own many times. Now, we're Christians. We love God. You have to be a Christian to have a relationship with God, right? I mean, you have to believe, and we're that. But too many times we want to add something to that, and we think, well, maybe I need to do this. No, God says, just get before my face and pour out your burdens to me. But the challenge is, you see in verse, when you get to verse 9 and 10, David reminds us, don't trust the world's ways to take care of this. He's saying, pour out your heart to God. Don't depend on the ways of the world. You see, David's talking about a sharp contrast here to trusting God. The sharp contrast is the danger of self-sufficiency. You see, the world tells us that we need to accumulate wealth and we need to gain power in order to be strong enough to defend ourselves and take care of ourselves in times of troubles. But the Bible tells us that we need to reject that type of philosophy because God is our source of strength. And God is our source of wealth. And anything else that you and I succumb to, it should be in Christ. It should be in God. And notice that David says there in verse 9 and 10, surely men of low degree are a vapor. Men of high degree are a lie. If they are weighed in the scales, they are altogether lighter than vapor. Do not trust in oppression. Do not vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. Listen, he's saying, don't go after the ways of the world, okay? Don't go after somebody who has a lot that you think, boy, if I just had that, my troubles would go away. David says it doesn't matter. Look at what he says here. God is neither impressed nor influenced by our possessions or our power. Men of low degree, men of high degree, poor and rich, common and noble, weak and mighty, they're all the same in God's sight, is what David is saying right here. He's saying, listen, we have nothing to offer God that He needs. God's got everything that He needs. Don't go searching after something out of the ways of the world that you think would impress God or would take care of your troubles. We have nothing to offer God that He needs. And notice he says there in verse 10, our very best is nothing more than vanity to Him, a vapor to Him. We have nothing that God needs. He says, don't revert to trusting in wealth and power. He's saying all that can do is lead to serious sin. When you think about oppression or extortion or stealing or worshiping wealth and thinking all of that's what you need to take care of your troubles, he's saying, don't do it. Don't do it. Not only do you wait quietly on God, he's saying you need to trust in God at all times. Listen, when our faith is challenged, one of the most helpful promises is this. You've read this verse many times, Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Paul wrote to the church at Philippi, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And then he says what happens, and the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Listen, when challenges come, we're tempted to respond in many different ways that are not going to be worthy of our walk with the Lord. And the challenge for us is to wait quietly on God at all times. The challenge for us is to trust in God at all times. And I was reminded about this yesterday. Many of you here have heard me have this saying, and I'll say it to these new students today. A lot of times we have a lot to think about, but we never have anything to worry about when it comes to God's control of our lives. So we wait quietly on Him at all times. We trust in God at all times. That means we don't allow anxiety to control us when those difficult circumstances come into our life. It means that we're calmed by those burdens, by taking those burdens to the Lord in prayer. And notice that David says God promises to give us that indescribable peace. You see, the most important thing about this 60-second psalm here is that the psalmist is making God his only object of trust. And I underscore that word only. You see, I think that's something that you and I, even as Christians today, need to learn. You see, I think a lot of times our problem is it's not that we do not trust God, at least in some sense. You know, we have to do that to be Christians, right? We have to trust Jesus Christ. We have to do that to be Christians. But sometimes we do not trust God only, is what I'm saying. Too many times we want to add something on our part to kind of rush God along or help God along sometimes. And David's telling us, look, I don't have to do that. I wait on God alone. I trust in God alone, not adding something else to it. It's kind of like the elderly man I heard about the other day. He was very apprehensive about his very first airplane ride. And after it was over, his friends were eager to hear how it went, and they wanted to know if he enjoyed the flight, his very first time, an older guy. And he said, well, it wasn't as bad as I thought it might be, but he said, I'll tell you this one thing, I never did put all my weight down in that seat. And I thought, that's just like us sometimes. We trust, but we don't sometimes put all of our weight down in that seat. I like what A.W. Tozer said. He said, God is looking for people through whom He can do the impossible. And what a pity that we plan only the things that we can do by ourselves. David said, we've got to wait quietly on God at all times. We've got to trust in God at all times. When we pour out our hearts and give our burdens to the Lord, when we leave our burdens with the Lord and fully trust Him to take care of us, that's when we can withstand those challenges. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. David says, wait. David says, trust God. But then the last thing you see there is in verses 11 and 12, and I want to say this, when those challenges to our faith come, not only do we trust God, but listen, I want to say to you, we got to trust God's Word. Okay? We've got to trust God's Word. Look at what David says. He says, now look here, God has spoken once, twice I have heard this, that power belongs to God. Also to you, O Lord, belongs mercy, for you render to each one according to his work. Do you trust God's Word? Do you? You believe this is the inspired, inerrant, infallible Word of God? I do. And if we're going to withstand the challenges that come to our faith, you and I better start looking at this more than just pages on a Word. This is the Word of God. And we have to trust not only God, but we have to trust God's Word. Because He's given it to us. And notice in verse 11 there, David says, God has spoken repeatedly of His ability to help us with our trouble. Notice he says, God said this once, and I've heard it more than once, okay? We have, haven't we? We have. See, he's talking about facing these challenges and that numerical sequence once and twice. It's a poetic way of saying that God has said this many times. You know, like I look at my kids or I've looked at my grandson, how many times I got to tell you this? You know, this is a good reminder to us when those challenges come that I've got to trust God's Word. You know, so David closes this 62nd Psalm by urging us, just simply, he's saying, trust what God's Word says to us. Verse 11, God is strong and powerful. He's able to meet our needs. You believe that? Trust God's Word. Verse 12, God is loving beyond our comprehension, and He's willing to meet our needs. You believe that? Trust God's Word. That word mercy there, we know what that word means. It's God's unfailing covenant love. We may fail the Lord, but I'll tell you what, He'll never fail us, for He is true to His Word. You believe His Word? When the challenges come, we must trust what God's Word says. Latter part of verse 12, God is sure. He is faithful to reward every person according to his or her work. When we trust the Lord and we obey His commands, He blesses us, He helps us, and we can be absolutely sure that He holds our situation in His hand. And listen to me, in His time and His way, He'll deal righteously with those who need to be dealt with. That's not on me. That's not on me. That's on God. And His Word says it. Do you trust God's Word? Therefore, we should wait quietly and rest on Him when our faith is challenged. I look at this psalm and I see that when David's faith was challenged, he found rest by recalling God's Word and believing what God said. When he could not see God at work, he chose to wait and to trust God completely to do all that he has promised. You know, when you get over into the New Testament, again, God reiterates that in the book of Hebrews, 11th chapter and verse 1, you see, believing what we cannot see is the very essence of our faith. We know that. That's what God's Word says. The world often describes the believer's faith as blind faith. That is, they say we foolishly believe something for which we have no basis. But let me tell you something, that could not be further from the truth. We have basis right here. The question is, do I believe God's Word? And David says, I believe God's Word. Therefore, when things are going on in my life around me that I can't explain, that I would choose not to have going around me, and you're going to possibly experience that this semester, then the question is, are you going to lash out? Are you going to blame God? Are you going to blame this one? Are you going to say like King David, my soul rests in God. My soul rests in God. Or I'm going to trust in God at all times because I believe what the Word of God says. I like what Oswald Chambers said. He said, faith for my deliverance is not faith in God. Faith means whether I am visibly delivered or not, I will stick to my belief that God is love. There are some things only learned in the fiery furnace. That's why Peter wrote to those Christians who were being persecuted for their faith and having challenges to their faith in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 19 through 21, when he said, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish, he was chosen before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end times for you, who through him are believers in God, who raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and your hope are in God. So my brothers and my sisters, praise God for the challenges of a new semester as they come our way. And I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the devil's up and ready to go against us. And he's ready to bring a challenge to your faith. He's ready to bring a challenge to my faith. But if we will put our trust in God's Word and do just like King David said, and when those challenges come, I'm going to choose to wait silently on God at all times. I'm going to choose to trust only in God at all times. And I'm going to say today, I choose to trust in the Word of God, who says at all times, at all places, He holds my situation in His hand, and my hope and my faith are in God alone. May it be so for me and you as we go through this new semester. Father, we love you today. God, thank you for a timely word. God, your word is always just right on time. Father, I thank you. Lord, I know that there's many in this room today that they've been overloaded with information and assignments. And Lord, I know the enemy's working at full speed today. He's got some of us saying, what are we even doing here? Are you out of your mind? You can't get all this done. You're not even supposed to be here. I know he's on right now. He's pulling at us. He's tugging at us. Father, today, thank you for a timely word through your servant King David, who reminded us that no matter who you are in God's army, you're going to undergo challenges to our faith. And God, today, as we face those, maybe somebody hasn't faced those yet, but as we go through this semester, help us to remember this 60-second psalm. And when those challenges come, God, help us not to lash out, but help us just to wait quietly. Give us rest in our souls. And God, as we proceed through that, help us to just remember, God, that we have to trust in you at all times. And Lord, we can do that because we believe what your word says. And Father, I love you for that. I love you. I praise you. I thank you for all of these folks who you've called to this place. And Lord, may this be the greatest semester we've ever had. May you be glorified in all that we say and do. For these wonderful professors who stand and teach and proclaim from the wisdom that you've given them throughout their service to you in their lives, I pray for them. I pray for these students, Lord, as they try to soak it all in and do everything that you've called them to do. I pray that when those challenges come, we'll stop and say, I trust in God alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. Have a good semester.